نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم اما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته الحمد لله with the great blessing of the almighty Allah عز وجل and his great mind Allah gave us the ability to complete the first 10 days of the month of Ramadan. From tonight we are starting the second 10 days. Tonight is the 11th Tarawih. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah azza wa jal has distributed these 10 days of the 30 days of the month of Ramadan into three portions. The first 10 days being the mercy, second 10 days being the maghfirah. And the last 10 days is that coming and now deliverance from the fire of hell. Although the mercy of Allah is throughout the month of Ramadan, it's not just after the 10 days no more mercy anymore, no. Mercy stays throughout the month of Ramadan. But the great number of mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal descends in the first 10 days. Now after receiving the mercy of Allah, what we are told to do is to ask for our forgiveness. And understanding the hope, because the mercy builds hope inside, correct? When you see someone is merciful, it gives you the ability to present yourself or your mistakes in front. So in the first 10 days when people have developed this mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal and a great hope in their life, now Allah Azza wa Jal is encouraging us for us to ask forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we don't feel sad in our life that I am doomed because I did really bad. Because that mercy is going to give you a hope that no matter how many sins I have committed or how many wrongs I have done in my life, Allah is always there to forgive. Allah Azza wa Jal is always there to forgive. So throughout these 10 days, a person should recite Astaghfirullah Rabbi min kulli dhanbin wa atubu ilayh. I seek forgiveness of Allah from all the sins that I have committed and I ask Allah Azza wa Jal to accept my repentance. Okay? So, and this doesn't have to be a specific time, whenever you have time. Or if you don't remember this whole thing, Astaghfirullah Rabbi min kulli dhanbin wa atubu ilayh, you can just stick to Astaghfirullah. Right? Astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, I ask your forgiveness. Even that much is enough. Whenever we get time for the sisters there at home, for the brothers at work, or you know, even the sisters at work, you are cooking, you are at home, you are going to your work, driving, whatever time you have and you remember this, just keep on reciting. And inshallah, towards the end of the second 10 days, Allah will put this contentment in your heart that Allah has forgiven your sins. So inshallah we will try to do this, all of us, throughout these 10 days of the month of Ramadan. As we started mentioning, the second thing which Surah Yasin consists of is bringing the sunnah and the teachings of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our life. Now when we hear the word sunnah, it has a dual meaning. One is the sunnah in prayers, right? You have the fard and then you have the sunnah prayers, right? This is a different sunnah from the sunnah that we talk about, establishing sunnah, practicing sunnah, bringing sunnah in your life. This is a different sunnah. The first one, which is after prayer, they are comparison to the obligatory prayer, that certain prayers are obligatory and certain prayers are not obligatory. And this is the distribution which is done by the jurists of the Ummah, Fuqaha Ummah, the scholars. And the reason why they did this, to give an understanding to a person that if certain things are up and down in certain ways, if your salah is accepted, if your salah is not accepted, these terminologies are there for you to determine if some mistakes have been made in your prayers, either your prayer was accepted or not, just on the merit of the terminology that this act is sunnah and this act is wajib or this act is fard. The sunnah that we have in discussion that we want to talk about is at-tariqah. The translation is tariqa, path. A path that you want to adapt in your life. Now, yesterday we stopped at where? Hadith or Sunnah. The difference between Hadith and Sunnah is, Hadith is merely the statement or the action or confirmation of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Statement, action, or confirmation. One of the threes, or all the threes, are the Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sunnah is al-tariqatul maslukatu fid-deen, a path which has been chosen for you to practice in your religion. What's the difference between the two? Many of times things may be hadith, but they might not be sunnah. Right? As we know, Islam has a gradual change in the 23 years of the period of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There were certain things which were made permissible before, but later on it was not permissible to do. For example, talking in salah. Before, people were allowed to talk, meaning greet someone, wa alaykum salam, upon someone says salamu alaykum in salah. Later on, this was made prohibited not to do. So the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that gave that permissibility earlier is also hadith. And the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited this action is also hadith. But the former is not sunnah, however the latter is sunnah. Now you get the difference? Right? This example, it opens up the meaning. Many times Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said certain things for certain people. This is why to understand sunnah, you need to understand the context of hadith, what this hadith is talking about. Is it confined to certain people in certain time, or is it for everyone? Or is it confined to certain conditions, or it is just a general rule? A few years ago, I was traveling, and at Fajr time, I ended up in one of the masjids. I'm not going to mention the city. It's in California. So I ended up in one of the masjid. Right in the morning, early, you know, we were driving, so we stopped at Fajr time, right before, you know, 30 minutes before Fajr. So we stopped outside. Masjid opened up 15 minutes before Fajr Salah. We went inside, made wudu, and we were waiting for prayed our sunnah and waiting for salah. Every person that would come in the masjid, he would pray two rak'ah sunnah and then he will go to sleep.
Go away.
He will go to sleep, he will lay down. Anybody that's coming in, prays two rak'ah sunnah, after that, he just lays down. I was like, okay, one person may be tired, two people tired, but this is the whole general tired, what's going on here? So I asked one of the brothers, you know, mashallah, you know, I see a very unique practice here. Whoever comes for Fajr Salah, he prays the sunnah, and after that, mashallah, he is knocked out. What's this? He says, brother, don't you know this is sunnah? Who? When did that happen? I was like, when did that happen? Don't you know there is a hadith of Bukhari, the Prophet Aisha radiallahu anha narrates that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would pray his two rak'ah sunnah of Fajr after praying after the adhan is called, and then he would lie down until Bilal would come, and he would knock at the door that the time of salah has come, and he would come out, and you know, the iqamah would be called and salah will start. I said, yes, I know this hadith. So this is sunnah. I said, you forgot the beginning part of this hadith. He says, what is that? I said, the beginning part of the hadith is the Prophet ﷺ would stand up in prayer throughout the last portion of the night. One third of the night he would spend in prayer. And after the time of tahajjud finishes, after the time of qiyamul layl finishes, he would hear the adhan, pray two rak'ah, and then after that rest for a few minutes, and then come and meet the salah. Right? But over here you're coming from home sleeping. Right? If you would have stayed up the whole night, or half one third of the night, it makes sense that you took some rest before the salah time starts. Right? Just to give energy. Why the Prophet ﷺ used to do this? To build energy for concentration in the Fajr Salah, to build energy in the concentration of the Fajr Salah. So I said, yes, if a person is standing up for one third of the night, after that the Adhan of Fajr is called, he prays his sunnah, and then he lays down for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, just to gain energy for his Fajr Salah, it makes sense. But you just woke up, you came for sunnah, then after that you came to masjid, you prayed your sunnah, and then you laid down considering it's sunnah, the whole masjid is practicing the sunnah.
So they're waiting for bid'ah.
So understanding hadith versus sunnah. What is the order of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? It's to practice the hadith or practice the sunnah? Right? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تَرَبْتُ فِيكُمْ أَمْرَيْنَ لَنْ تَضِيلُوا مَا إِنْ تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّتِهِ. He never said hadithi, right? He did sunnatihi. Similarly, in another hadith, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِّينَ وَإِنَّهُ يَعِيشُ مِنْ بَعْدِي فَسَيَرَى اخْتِلَافٌ كَثِيرًا فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ. Those people who will live after me, they will see a lot of differences of opinion. They will see a lot of اختلاف. They will see a lot of people arguing about many things. At that time, what you want to adhere to? You want to adhere to my sunnah and the sunnah of the four guided khalifa. So understanding sunnah and practicing it in your life. Now, to the Sahaba, everything was for them, if the Prophet encouraged them to do or he did it, they would just follow him. Correct? This terminology of sunnah, fara'id, wajib, all of these things, this came later on. It came later on for our betterment of understanding, not to leave it. Because today we think sunnah is something not to practice. Right? This is sunnah, meaning we don't have to practice. No. Sunnah means that to bring it into your life. It's just a matter of making a better understanding. But as far as the practice, whose sunnah is this? Whose tariqah is this? Because we said, a sunnah, what tariqah? What tariqah is it? It's a path. Whose path is this? This is not my path. This is not your path. This is the path of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in Surah Yasin, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions وَالْقُرْآنِ الْحَكِيمِ إِنَّكَ لَمِنَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. When we accept Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as being the Prophet, then adapting his lifestyle into our life is the path to success. Now, many of times we read things or we understand things out of context and we think this is, you know, problematic to mention or to talk about in Islam. This is because we've understood it wrong. And this is why you have people who have specialized in hadith. These are called muhaddithin. You have people who are specialized in the commentary of the Quran. These are called mufassirin, right? And then you have people who are specialized in fatwa. And these are called fuqaha, al-muftiyun, right? Why do you have these categories? Because these people, they understand the whole background of it. Now, preservation of hadith was done similar to the preservation of Quran, and when it came to the matter of giving this end to the ummah. So today, a person is easy for him to say, oh, this is just the saying of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you know, we don't have to practice it much, just make sure the Quran is all right. No. We cannot understand the Quran without Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And we cannot understand Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam without the climate. Right? Without the climate where the Quran and the Sunnah was mentioned and revealed. So Quran and Sunnah, they go hand to hand. Whatever the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, that salvation from all type of problems are left in two things, Quran and Sunnah. Adapting the lifestyle. And the lifestyle of Rasulullah ﷺ is such that in every avenue of our life, there is guidance for us. How to be a perfect husband? The life of the Prophet ﷺ will tell us. How to be a perfect father? The life of the Prophet ﷺ will tell us. How to be a perfect neighbor? The Prophet ﷺ's life will tell us. How to be the best employee? This is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. How to be the best employer? This is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. How to treat your parents? This is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recommended it. So these are avenues of life. And in these avenues of life, what do we need to put inside? We need to put sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam inside. When we will put the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ in the avenues of our life, our problems will be solved. Our problems will be solved. Why? Because we are doing what is right. Because the Prophet ﷺ never told people to do what is wrong. He had always cared for people. He always had love and affection for people. He looked at the rights of every single gender and every single category, and he fulfilled those rights. Today, when we talk about, especially the Muslim community, we are founding ourselves in Islam, but the true religion is gone. This is one of the signs of the Day of Judgment. لا يبقى من الإسلام إلا اسمه. Only the name of the religion will be kept, that I am a Muslim, but in practice there is nothing of Islam. Honesty, love and affection, caring for other people, being a good citizen. Being a good citizen, Islam teaches us how to be a good citizen. These are all teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we will do these two things, which are mentioned in the beginning of Surah Yaseen, number one is Quran al-Hakim, right? Adopting, understanding, implementing, practicing the Book of Allah. Number two is making Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a guidance for your life, and practicing his sunnah in every avenue. What Allah will do to us? Ala siratin mustaqim. You will be on the straight path. You will be on the straight path. You see the connection? You see this connection Allah is mentioning in this surah? This is why this surah is called Qalbul Quran, the heart of Quran, right? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَإِنِّي لَأُحِبُّ أَنَّ هَذِهِ السُّورَةَ فِي قَلْبِ كُلِّ أُمَّتِ. I would love that this surah is in the heart of every ummati of mine. This is the desire of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not just the memorization, but the practice and understanding of it in our hearts. May Allah grant us the understanding to do that. May Allah give us the ability to practice on this. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta.